Welcome back. Great to have you with us on The Full View. We continue to explore the legacy of Robert Mugabe. The man who took power after Mugabe was ousted as president in 2017 has called him an icon of liberation. Zimbabwean President Emmerson Mnangagwa said today Mugabe was an Africanist who dedicated his life to the emancipation of his people. In later years, of course, Mugabe cut a more controversial figure, accused of the violent oppression of his political opponents. For some analysis, we're joined by Pan-Africanist and constitutional and international relations lawyer Brian Kagoro. Great to have you with us in studio,
Thank
Brian.
Thank you for having me.
Because there's such differing views, just very quickly, how do you remember Robert Mugabe today?
I remember him as a phenomenally eloquent, erudite man who's rhetorically was committed to a left-leaning ideology, a Pan-Africanist ideology, but whose practice of leadership in the country from the beginning in 1980 was dogged by what one can describe as a measure of intolerance towards any form of opposition, whether that opposition came in the form of Mr. Joshua Nkomo and ZAPU, or that opposition came in the form of the Foreign Party of Zimbabwe, Mr. Dumbuchena, or later on Morgan Tsvangirai.
Yeah.
And I think that it would be remiss for anyone to judge Mugabe simplistically as using this. When you look at the Zimbabwean crisis, you use the acronym IMF, which means it's Mugabe's fault. There are many things that he inherited that were structurally problematic. The economy was in structural chaos. It seemed to be doing well, but if you look at the one thing, though, that he could have changed was the state apparatus that had been used to oppress liberation forces and black people by the Rhodesian Front. He instead refined that apparatus. He used it to consolidate his power. And in the 80s, part of his challenge was he tried to move the country towards a one-party state, hence his fallout with his then Secretary General and friend, Edgar Tekere. This attempt to consolidate power, to personalize power, was the Achilles heel of his Pan-Africanism.
Well, let's start in the 80s, if we kind of do a timeline, because you have that historical knowledge. So one of the most controversial at times, the 1980s killings in Matabele land of Ndebeles, 20,000 Ndebeles were killed by state forces. Was this a strong hand against political opponents who were a threat to him, maybe a threat to the country? Or was this, like some believe, brutal ethnic cleansing?
It could have been a bit of both. The 1980s were characterized, it was during the Cold War. The regime in South Africa, the apartheid regime, was sponsoring all sorts of insurgency, including RENAMO, and the Americans were sponsoring insurgency in Angola. Mm. So there was, within the ruling nationalist elite across the region, a sort of anxiety that there were real threats to constitutional order. But the response to Matabeleland was disproportionate to the threat. The response was to dissidents, but it targeted civilians, not the identified or the claimed military threat. Any response by a military that leads to the death of so many civilians should be seen as having been intentional and a deliberate attempt.
And a war crime?
It is. By all intents and purposes, it is a war crime. He escaped it because he couldn't have been tried under the Rome Statute, under ICC, because the Rome Statute, as you know, came into existence after the crime had been committed. And in any event, because of the fact of the Unity Accord in 1987, going to 88, the feuding parties, or the most affected of the entities, which was ZAPU, agreed to join his government, whether it was coerced or willingly agreed. I mean, that's for historians to debate.
Mm. So then there was a long period of sort of unfettered power, maybe. But if we fast forward to 2000, you are one of those who believe that Mugabe was actually defeated in elections, I believe. What happened there?
Yeah, so the period in 1987, we moved towards the imperial presidency. Therein began our problems. We had challenges with the Gukurahundi, but Gukurahundi, it would be wrong to say it was only Mugabe. The current president is heavily implicated, so were other senior ZANU officials. It was a collective decision. I dare every historian who's interested in studying that era to go and read parliamentary debates in which ZANU-PF members of parliament and not Mugabe used the most acerbic terms to refer to ZAPU and other folk that they saw as enemies. But when we move to 1987, we have the presidential, the amendment number 7 to the constitution, which vested in Mugabe almost imperial presidential powers. The personalization of the state began then.
Okay.
And that personalization of the state needed the assurance of a very militaristic hand. Before, the military was used to fight randomly identified enemies. You could objectively say there may have been some enemies. The military overreacted. But post-1987, the military served almost as handmaid of interest that Mugabe had, which was consolidation of power. And as we exited the Cold War era, the military was more and more, and so were security organs, used to contain internal threats.
Okay. So link this to elections, 2000.
Yeah, so you get to, so the civic groups came together and indicated that we needed a new constitution. And part of the reason why we needed a new constitution was to address the long standing problem with the issue of land ownership and distribution. The second were the presidential powers, that Mugabe had excessive powers that were unchecked, that you couldn't have a balance of forces. So we got into that constitutional debate, then a referendum in 2000. The objection to the referendum in 2000 is that the constitution that was being proposed by ZANU-PF would have had a mandatory conscription of anybody under the age of 35 into national service. It would have allowed Mugabe to deploy the army within Zimbabwe without the sort of parliamentary oversight that we had. So the objection to that constitution was that nuance. He lost that referendum. So there was no attempt to rig the referendum. If it was there, they failed to do it. And violence began on the 4th of March. Targeted, and I must explain why that targeting was important. Targeted at the farming areas and the rural areas. Mugabe realized that the urban areas, because of the referendum results, had essentially moved towards an anti-establishment sentiment. Mm. There were about 1 million workers on the farms, which would have meant that in terms of a voting population, 500,000 workers on the farms, in terms of a voting population, it would have come to about 1 million. And the destabilization on the farms, whilst it was posited as a land reform, part of it, if you look at which farms were targeted, how they were targeted, and the logistical approach that was taken, you can tell that there was a dual approach to it. One, there was the redistribution issue. Nobody disputes that we needed to redistribute land. The opposition didn't even dispute that. Number two, it was containing the capacity of the opposition to mobilize the middle voice. You have the rural vote in Zimbabwe, which ZANU-PF was assured it could get. You have the urban vote, which it knew it had lost. Then you had the middle vote, which is the 1 million votes. And if you see how many votes Mugabe had gotten since 1980 to retain the presidency, it was less than 2.5 million.
Okay.
So with the sort of votes that you could get from the farming areas, that's why that election became very violent. It was extremely violent.
Yeah.
We lost a lot of our comrades that were killed, disappeared, tortured, detained. All sorts of things happened.
Because suddenly his power that you said was consolidated in him as a person was under threat.
His power was under threat, but much more than his power. The rhetoric adopted during those days was that he needed to be held accountable for what had happened in the 80s. So there was a genuine concern both with the loss of power, and that loss of power came with potential criminal prosecution.
Brian, we're running out of time, so I guess a simple question is, if he actually lost the election in 2000 and the claims of vote rigging were real, why did it take nearly two more decades for Robert Mugabe to be ousted, and then it came from within his own party? Some believe maybe if the opposition was more united, history would have turned out differently for those two decades.
I think that those are people who don't understand the conflation of the ruling party with the military and the economy. In countries such as South Africa, your military is not very active in ANC politics. If your military were active in ANC politics and was willing to act as they did in Marikana, your police, in defense of sectarian internal party feuds, you would have a bloodbath in this country. So I'm glad that the opposition did not take a largely confrontational approach. We would have had a bloodbath much earlier. Mugabe was prepared to use any means to stay in power. That's one. But number two, the Zimbabwean opposition believed that the transfer of power in a democratic Zimbabwe should be done through constitutional means, should be done through an electoral way. In order, because unlike most countries in the region, other than Mozambique and Angola, our country had a war, a live war fought on our soil. And a lot of people don't, we had a 15-year war fought on our soil. After that 15-year war, we had 6 years of this Gukurahundi. So the level of appetite for any more violence from among Zimbabweans was much lower. And you'd get the same sentiment amongst Congolese and other people who have had a live war fought on their soil. So it was, we were not speculating or treating violence as academic. But number two, I suppose when you have a highly educated population, one of the dangers that comes with it is the notion that shaming, that there would be a measure of civility, that shame would suffice, that a person would realize that they have not done sufficiently. But let's not forget that this region, this country in particular, South Africa, stood in solidarity with Mugabe because certain forces within the ruling ANC did not believe in the opposition. Having experienced Zambia, they feared that the opposition offered a Chiluba II moment, that there would be a gateway through which what they saw as imperial forces would weave their way into the region and undermine what they saw as a progressive agenda of liberation movements. And I think in that, the responsibility for the non-transition in Zimbabwe must be shared. The statement issued from this country following that bloody election was that the election was unfair, but is a legitimate representation of the will of the Zimbabweans. Yeah. Without the support of the region or the collusion of the region, things might have turned out much more differently. It would have emboldened Zimbabweans to take an approach to unshackling themselves from Mugabe that's slightly different. And I dare say that 2008 election was lost. Everybody knows Mugabe lost 2008. The military intervened to keep him in power, including the current president.
Can I just crystallize this, because we're running out of time? You say South Africa supported an illegitimate president.
I think that we must say it boldly. There is a lot of denialism. They may not have realized the net effect of it. The net effect of it is they knew that there had been an election in which people had been beaten, some maimed and killed, and they still proceeded to say the legitimate will of the people had been. They would not accept the same standards in South Africa for an election. For some reason, the people across the Limpopo can live with any substandard quality of election. It is fine, right? And that is what this Pan-African solidarity must have two anchors, a clear anti-imperialism, but also a clear intolerance towards unconstitutional behavior, especially in governance.
All right, fascinating. Thank you for that sweep of history in Zimbabwe, for your views. That was Pan-Africanist and constitutional and international relations lawyer Brian Kagoro.